JoAnn Bontjes. In 1975, JoAnn lived in a small rural area of Minnesota, known as Martin County. Although she was just 21 years old, JoAnn had already established herself as an ambitious hairdresser with a head for business. She owned her own salon already and was gaining a reputation for quality work. She never did anything halfway. She was described as being principled, headstrong, and assertive. Then, on October 1st, 1975, a vicious act took it all away. The night started out normally. She was out having a drink with her friends at a bar known as the Knight's Lounge. The bar itself is located on the edge of town in an area that's not well lit or busy. It's reported that she told those that she was with that she was heading home to Tremont, which was west of the bar. But she left the bar at 12:30 a.m. going a different direction. She began driving south. Witnesses reported seeing her white Chevy Vega head south, and the working theory is that she went in that direction in order to meet and speak with someone first, perhaps someone she had hoped to see that night at the bar. She never arrived at home that night, and her car would be found later, parked off the side of the road, and while there were signs of a nearby struggle, she was nowhere to be found. JoAnn's keys and purse were found still inside the vehicle. The car door was wide open, the window was down, but she was nowhere to be seen. It would take a day and a half before she was located in a shallow ditch near a farm. She had been shot in the temple and had passed away only 6 hours before. It is believed she was kept captive for approximately 30 hours prior to being found in the ditch. A nearby farmer reported hearing a shot, and while hunting season was to start at noon the next day, it was uncommon to hear only one blast and nothing more. If someone was hunting, you would hear usually more shots, so they're pretty certain this was the shot that took her life. The blast itself came from the area southeast of the Donnie Faber farm, near the local gravel pits. She wouldn't be found until 7 a.m. on October 2nd. A man JoAnn never met has made this case a central part of his retirement. Don Mickelson spent 22 years as a chief of police in the rural town of St. James, Minnesota. To him, this was a case that needed focus, and it was something he was more than willing to provide. While he was never someone working on JoAnn's case directly, she mattered to him, and he has pledged to solve the case if at all possible. He took it upon himself to dedicate his own time and money to interview witnesses, possible suspects, and he was always meticulous in chasing down every lead. He is the source of the Facebook page dedicated to JoAnn, Justice for JoAnn Bontjes. Mickelson has made a plea on Facebook for her friends to come together and work with him on this case. The undercurrent of the plea seems to be that this is a small town, and as such, small town dynamics are going on, where people are less likely to report what they know. Mickelson talks about how there will be no chance of retaliation, as the person would be arrested, and please come forward and do the right thing. On the screen now is a post from that Facebook page that I'm not allowed to verbalize because of YouTube rules. Without specifically saying who, it's clear that Don Mickelson seems to indicate there is an open secret about who took JoAnn's life, and because of those small town dynamics, he's still free. Posts explain that she was a strong woman, both in body and soul, who was hurt in order to get revenge and keep her from telling one man's fiance truth about something she knew. She was a strong woman, both in body and soul, who was hurt in order to get revenge as well as keep her from telling the man's secret. This theory that it's for revenge and stopping her is bolstered by the fact that she was only physically assaulted. There was no other type of assault. Early in Mr. Mickelson's investigation, there were reports of a local man who had done many terrible things outside of murder, but there was no known link to JoAnn. However, this investigation did point to a man who was very open in his hatred for JoAnn. A huge negative in this case is that the officers officially involved refused to initiate contact with Don Mickelson, even though he's done so much work on this case. Some will take his calls, but they leave him to feel like no one in law enforcement is actually working the case or wants to solve it. That also could be part of the small town dynamic. Maybe they don't want to solve it. Maybe there is a reason in that small town that they don't want this solved. Don Mickelson stands firm, and he is trying very hard to figure out who took JoAnn's life. He and his friends, in fact, have raised a reward. If anyone has any information, my advice is to contact Don Mickelson through Facebook as well as the police. Sounds like there are definite issues involving the police in this case. Hopefully I'm wrong, but JoAnn's best case scenario might come from both being contacted. I have provided the Martin County Sheriff's Department's phone number on the screen. Facebook page can be found by searching out Justice for JoAnn Bontjes. Her last name is spelled B-O-N-T-J-E-S. JoAnn's case has gone unsolved for 46 years. That's it for today. Thank you everyone so much for watching and listening. Please take a moment to like and subscribe if you haven't already. We have new episodes every Monday and Thursday. Thursdays are always dedicated to John and Jane Doe cases. Take care of yourselves and each other.